doctrine of why men fail to get the benefits of the program of God, this wonderful plan for man that we've been discussing the past few months. Men fail to prosper and get from God because they do not use for others what they have. They are too selfish and stingy. They have no faith that God will replenish if they should happen to give of their means to help others. They are full of worry and unbelief. They are afraid to launch out in new opportunities to make good in life. They have no vision to tackle anything. They pray, and when God answers their prayer to bless them materially, they will hesitate until the opportunity goes by. They are not diligent in business and unselfish in their motive to get rich or to get health and happiness. These conditions must be corrected in the personal life before anything in a definite way can be expected in life as promised in the gospel. We'll see in our future programs and studies that every believer can have the full and absolute power of God over the devil and over demons, and can get physical, spiritual, and material benefits from God to the full. The only thing left to deal with here is concerning man's need for this life. The material needs of a believer are quite often brought up. If one thinks that we emphasize too much about material needs, then let him start reading the Bible for himself and see the many, many promises of God concerning the material needs of God's people. Why should we withhold this phase of life from anyone to whom God makes such glowing promises as we've seen in our lessons from time to time? It would be a sin on our part to know of the abundance of truth along this line and fail to make it clear so that all men might finally be awakened to realize that they can seek truth and seek salvation and seek health and seek happiness and material prosperity as well. No man can be at his best when he is oppressed and worried all the time about how he is going to get his next car payment, his house rent, or even food and clothes for his own loved ones. These are great burdens to the average man, and it is a shame that all churches do not reveal to their members the abundant provision of God for such needs. It would be to their advantage, and it would bring great glory to God when sinners see how the believers are happy and blessed with health and material things. On the other hand, when sinners see saints living far below their standard of living and know that they are being prospered and blessed above Christians, it certainly does not tend to make them desirous of giving up their life for the Christian life. If the full truth about material help from God would be taught according to the Bible, the preachers would not have to beg for money in every service or use unscriptural means to raise money for the church work as many men do. If men in churches were taught the gospel of prosperity and how to prosper in life, and they would actually experience material help from God enough to be encouraged and to help others to be encouraged, then we would see a different type of giving for the work of God on every hand. The Bible does tell us in Malachi 3:10-12 to bring all of our tithes into the storehouse and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord, and I will open up the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing you will not be able to contain or receive. Members who realize that God has been good to them and that they have what they do have because of his goodness would gladly give to supply others. After all, this is what money and material things are for. I want you to notice some scriptures along this line. And as ye would that men should do to you, do ye also to them likewise. For if ye love them which love you, what thank have you? For sinners also love those that love them. And if ye do good to them which do good to you, what thank have you? That's the idea in this passage. We know that we're no better than the sinner if that's all we can do in life. And if we lend to them of whom we hope to receive, what thank have we in doing that? For sinners also lend to sinners to receive as much again. But Jesus said, love your enemies, do good, and lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great, And ye shall be called the children of the Highest, for he is kind unto the unthankful and to the evil. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. Judge not, and ye shall not be judged. Condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned. Forgive, and ye shall be forgiven. And then we have a statement like this. Given, it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. This passage not only gives the law of God and the moral obligation to give, but it also gives laws of prosperity. We continue the passages on this idea in Romans 12 and 13, where Paul said, distributing to the necessity of the saints, given to hospitality. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is a fulfilling of the law. Then we have another statement. If we have sown unto you spiritual things, is it a great thing that we shall reap your carnal things? Even so hath the Lord ordained that they which preach the gospel should live of the gospel. He which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man, as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful, or literally a hilarious, giver. God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. Let him that is taught in the word communicate, that is, give of your material gain unto him that teacheth in all good things. And we're told also in the Bible that men get saved and do good works, and that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, that is, give of their goods to others. Then we have many, many other statements in the Bible expressing the same idea. So if all Christians would have faith in God and carry out the simple laws of prosperity laid down in these passages, and in some of the other statements we'll be giving you from time to time, then they could find the material blessings of God, and that the laws of prosperity are still workable today, or are still working for men today. God will make ways and present opportunities to make success. And one must not be afraid to launch out in new ventures as one gets to know the will of God in prayer and as possibilities present themselves. Have faith, reckless faith if need be, and God will honor the faith. And the new venture will succeed. Then as you use material gains for the good of others, God will enlarge your capacity for more and make you an ever-increasing channel of supply and blessing to others. One must start with a love to do things for others. Love is the start of all worthwhile achievements in life. You cannot love God and keep his commandment without also loving your fellow men, and also keeping the second commandment, which is, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and the second one is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. If you obey these commandments, you will observe the golden rule. You will be interested in helping others to get along in life. You will work for others. You will sacrifice self-interest for the interest of others. You will then make many friends. And you cannot make friends without gaining in prosperity yourself. Your friends will help you succeed in your business. Friends will want to help you. Do not forget to take the opportunities that will come to you in life and make the best of them. And always with a view of doing good to others, not to get something for your own selfish interests altogether, but do things to help others. You will give without thought of getting. You will serve without thought of reward. You will succeed spiritually, physically, and financially. The law of Christ is, whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life shall find it. In doing things for Christ, you do things for others. Inasmuch as you have done it unto the one of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Christ taught us that the law of increase is to use what we have to use. And we'll do this, we will prosper. The man with 5 talents gained 5 more for his master. The one with 2 talents gained 2 more. And the one that took the 1 talent and hid it in the ground lost everything. The widow in Elisha's day merely used what she had. There was a great increase. She wanted this money to pay her debts and save her children. And so the oil came out of the vessel until her debts were paid. When we start with the idea of what we should be able to do for others, there is every chance of success. Look forward to real service to others, and soon your hands will be full of good deeds and loving memories of good done here and there, and others will be giving back to you. That's the promise of Jesus Christ himself in Luke 6:30-38. Look for work that will help others. Sell goods and services that will help people in their problems. Give sound, godly, and biblical advice to all men that you contact. Be honest in the smallest business details. Thank God for blessings you need and want. Have faith that they are yours. Make plans for the proper and unselfish use of blessings. Be pleasant and happy before all men. Be thankful for your work. Don't try to reach the top in one day. Be diligent in business, cheerful in giving, merciful in dealings, kind and sympathetic and understanding to all men. Put your faith in God and his promises and claim their benefits. Trust God in adversity. Let any failure become a stepping stone to something greater. Use your influence for good and for God and lost souls. Help those in sickness and need. Pray earnestly to succeed and be blessed with all the good things in this life. And above all, get right with God and consecrate yourself to the best good of the universe and make God your partner in life. Believe that God wants you to have material prosperity and wants you to have health, wants you to have all these good things in life. Believe, and they will come to you. Live in faith and do things accordingly, and you will find the benefits of God rich in your life. For we have the promise that we have exceeding great and precious promises, that by these we might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, and that we can have all things that pertain to life and godliness in this life as well as in the life to come. Read 1 Peter or 2 Peter 1, verses 3 to 4, and you'll find such a simple statement as that. Every provision for life now and hereafter.